Hello, welcome to this presentation about the estimation of the pesticide-induced impact on human health. My name is Sörgrab. Since April 2013, I'm a PhD student in the working group of mathematical modeling at the University of Koblenz-Landau, Campus Landau. My PhD thesis deals with maps about the temporal and spatial distribution of human diseases and the exposure to pesticides in developing countries. In this presentation, I will show you a method about how to estimate the pesticide-induced impact on human health. First, I will show you an example for the application of risk maps in an early warning system. Then, I will present you a general definition of risk and how this definition is related to the pesticide-induced risk on human health. Next, I will explain how the pesticide-induced impact is related to the conditions in the agricultural workflow and how the impact on human health can be estimated. Last, I will talk about the limitations of this method and give a short conclusion. Here, we can see an example for an early warning and response cycle and where my work is integrated and how risk maps can be used. They are used in the steps between the generation of an early warning and the step called activation of the response of the health system. This slide shows a prototype of an early warning and response system and a potential application of risk maps. The map on the upper left side is a randomly created risk map for an epidemiological problem. The map on the upper right side shows the spatial distribution of available resources to solve this problem. With this prototype, you have, for example, the possibility to compare the spatial risk with the spatial distribution of the available resources. With this information, you can create a map showing the spatial distribution of areas where intervention is needed. You can also send warnings to different user groups, for example, to public health agencies, to public health workers, or to people in high-risk areas. In general, risk is defined as the product of the probability of a hazard and the potential impact of the hazard. With the help of this definition, it is possible to calculate a value for the risk for a specific hazard and to compare the risk, for example, for different person groups or for people living in different areas. In the case of chemicals or poisons, the impact on human or ecosystem health is calculated by two variables: the toxicity of a substance and the dose or concentration the organisms are exposed to that substance. The probability is a value between 0 and 1 and can be understood as, for example, the probability that an organism or person stays in the recognized area. The risk is calculated by multiplying the probability and the potential impact. Risk maps illustrate the spatial distribution of the calculated risk values. Here we can see a so-called risk matrix. The red color means high risk, the yellow color medium risk, and the green color low risk. On the y-axis, we have the height of the potential impact. On the x-axis, we have the probability of the hazard. The level of risk is defined by these two variables. The highest risk is in cases where the impact and the probability are high. The lowest level of risk where we have a low impact and a low probability. In the case of pesticides, this means that we can decrease the level of risk either by decreasing the impact through using less toxic pesticides or by decreasing the exposure, or we can decrease the level of risk by decreasing the probability that a person stays in an area where the pesticides are applied to. In developing countries, the most people affected by pesticide-induced health problems are people involved in the agricultural production process. The negative impact on human health caused by pesticides is dependent On the toxicity and on the concentration the agricultural workers are exposed to. The concentration varies with the application rate. Also, the working field determines the concentration. For example, pesticide mixers or sprayers are exposed to higher concentrations than crop pickers. Also, the type of the cultivated crop determines the exposition to pesticides. For example, the drift of pesticides and thus the amount which doesn't reach the crop and stays in the air is in the cultivation of tree crops higher than in the cultivation of non-tree crops. Beside the mentioned factors, also the type of the used spraying equipment and the type of the used protective clothing determine the pesticide concentration people are exposed to, and thus the uptaken pesticide amount. In the following part of this presentation, I will give you an example how the impact on the human health of a pesticide applicator can be estimated, based on the toxicity of the used substance and the exposure to the substance. First, we have to rate the used pesticide related by its hazard to the human health. The WHO classifies pesticides in 5 classes, from U to 1A. U means unlikely to present acute hazard, 1A means that a pesticide is extremely hazardous. The classification is based on the LD50 for rats. LD50 stands for lethal dose 50 and is that dose where 50% of the organisms in a rat population die. With the help of this value, the impact of substances to mammals is estimated. According to the WHO classification, we can rate the hazard of the used pesticide with a value between 0 and 1. In the next step, the agricultural workers' exposure to the pesticide is estimated. The exposure for a pesticide sprayer can be estimated, for example, by the applicated amount of the used pesticide, the drift rate of the spraying equipment, and the used protective clothing. The applied pesticide amount is the amount released to the environment. A part of the applicated pesticide amount, dependent on the application method, gets into the air. Through the use of protective clothing, the uptaken pesticide dose can be reduced. For example, through the use of a breathing mask, nearly no pesticides are uptaken. The values for the drift rate or the uptaken amount can be taken from scientific literature, or they have to be evaluated. An impact factor must be calculated to estimate the impact on human health in area and to compare the level of risk for different application cases. For the example presented here, the impact factor is calculated by multiplying the applied amount with the drift rate of the used spraying equipment, with the uptake rate, with the toxicity value, and the number of agricultural workers in the observed area. Here we can see an example for 2 different cases. In both cases, a low toxic pesticide is applied with an airplane and with an application rate of 0.1 kg per hectare. The agricultural workers wear no protective clothing. In the first case, one agricultural worker is exposed to the pesticide. In the second case, 100 agricultural workers stay in the field after application. The impact factor is in the second case 100 times greater than in the first case. This can be explained with the fact that in the second case, 100 workers are affected by the pesticide exposure and in the first case only 1. The shown method has a few limitations. First, not all factors which determine the impact are recognized in this method. You see, the impact is also dependent on the exposure duration, on the working time in the field after application and the dissipation time of the pesticide. These factors are not integrated in the presented method. Also, the WHO classification of the pesticides into toxicity classes has disadvantages. The classification is based on toxic endpoints of toxicity laboratory tests, like the LD50. Conclusions about a dose-response relationship can be drawn from the LD50 and from this classification. This means that a pesticide classified as highly hazardous can be less hazardous for low concentrations than a pesticide classified as moderately hazardous. To solve this problem, it would be better to use a substance-specific equation of the dose-response relationship than toxic endpoints like the LD50. Another problem is the spatial resolution of the available input data. E.g., often we have only the average application rate for large areas, like countries or federal states. But the application rates vary sometimes for neighboring farmers for the same crop. For example, if they don't follow mixing rules, and thus the individual impact factors are different from the average impact factor. Also, data about the use of protective clothing or about the used spraying equipment is often not available. These informations can be principally gained by questionnaires, but it is a large effort to perform such a data collection in large areas, and often too expensive. With the help of the presented method, it is possible to estimate the impact on person groups in a specific area. But the method has also some limitations. For example, often the spatial distribution of the input parameters, e.g. about the application rates or the wear of protective clothing, are not available. This means that a lot of scientific work and also data collection have to be done. We have to keep in mind that we calculate the impact on human health. It would be an inexcusable mistake if the impact is calculated as low, although it is high. This can have a negative effect on the health of humans. Thus, this method should only be used in a protective way. For example, only for pesticides, for which the equation for dose-response relationship can be taken from scientific literature or from agency reports. Thank you for your attention. If you have questions, you can write me an email or you can ask me in the following flash meeting.